If I could call the meeting to order and have the clerk lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you and welcome, everybody, for joining us tonight. If I can have a motion, a second, that the for the approval of our agenda of November 15th, 2016 be approved as submitted.
So moved.
Any questions, comments? All those in favor? Thank you. If I could have a motion, a second, for the approval of the consent agenda, including the approval of the minutes of November 1st as submitted, acceptance of recommendations from the Committee on Special Education, acceptance of recommendations from the Committee on Preschool Special Education, acceptance of recommendations from the Superintendent for Personnel Changes and the amended changes that we received, and a request to approve the recommended bidders for various multimedia and energy cooperative bidding.
So moved.
Any questions? All those in favor? Thank you. We also had a treasurer's report for the month ending September 30th, 2016 that we all reviewed and looked at. Could I have a motion and a second that the treasurer's report, including the cash report, general fund cash report, general fund revenue status report, general fund budget status report, school lunch fund cash report, and school lunch fund revenue and expense budget report for the month ending September 30th, 2016 be approved?
So moved.
Any questions on that report? All those in favor? Thank you. And I'll let Dr. Putnam introduce our secondary school action plan reports.
Wonderful. We had, if you remember, last board meeting, we had our elementary school principals reviewing their action plans with us in the community. And then tonight we have Dr. Maloney and Mr. Buddington for our secondary school action plans for the high school and Bay Trail. And I will point out, because you may not see them on camera, is just like the secondary principals came to support their elementary comrades, we have our elementary principals here in support of our secondary principals. And so I did mention after the elementary principals left that I did not tell them they had to come. So this is on their own, and I do appreciate it very much. I think it says a lot about moving towards that Team Penfield goal. So thank you. I'll turn it over to Leslie and Winton.
Well, we thank you for the opportunity to come and share our school action plans for this year with the board and also with our community at home. The plans continue to support the board goals, and it's one thing that we're very appreciative of, the consistency in the board goals and how that enables us to actually make progress. When things keep changing from that board goal direction, it's hard to track progress and really move things forward in the building. So having that consistency has really helped for the past few years. Our academic goals from last year, our outcomes from last year, really focused around our guaranteed viable curriculums, looking at our intervention systems, our assessments, how are we gathering our data on students, and as well reaching out around our emergency practice and procedures so that we can provide that safe environment at both the middle school and the high school to be that safe learning environment for everybody. Our partnership goals last year looked at building our continued partnerships within the district as students transition levels for Bay Trail, both from elementary school and then on to the high school, and for the high school building from Bay Trail and on to the community. In addition, building our partnerships with the community and reaching out and developing new partnerships and new relationships with community and using our electronic tools to develop those new relationships. And last year with our fiscal responsibility, looking at how best to meet the needs of our students with the resources we have in the district, whether looking at staffing, in supplies and resources in our communication tools. So as we look to the 16-17 school year for Bay Trail, building off of those goals and continuing that work, looking at our four essential questions of learning: what do we want students to know? How do we know if they know it? What do we do if they do? What do we do if they don't? This provides the structure for that. As we continue to look at our guaranteed and viable curriculum and looking at that experience students are having, no matter which house they're in at Bay Trail, are they getting that same curriculum, that same experience? Recognizing that that building happening within Bay Trail, as well as preparing students for the high school, we want to make sure that we have that guaranteed curriculum that's accessible to all students, that's viable for them, and consistent no matter which house and which teacher they have for their courses. Looking at what do we do and what do we, if they do, what do we do if they don't, the two sides of our RTI. For those students that need additional supports, are we being timely and targeted in those supports? And for the students that do get it, what are we doing? How are we helping them stretch? How are we helping them grow, not just through accelerated classes, but also through other exploratory experiences? So keeping that perspective in mind is still a focus for this year. And then looking at purposefully, what are we doing to support the whole child? And how do we help students continue to develop, to be themselves, to help express themselves? And what are those programs that we had in place, and what are those programs that we need to look at doing to continue the whole child development? This year we had students advocate for an OQS Alliance, and so that club has started, which stands for Out Questioning and Straight Alliance Students. And so that's providing students that opportunity to continue conversations about being who they are and being comfortable, as well as helping us deal with any issues that arise from those different self-expressions. Our other initiatives that we're continuing, we just wrapped up our Mix It Up and Make a Difference days in the cafeteria. A lot of glitter everywhere, but some great organizations that were supported, and four stations, kids are up involved, moving around. Our Care and Community Ambassadors next week are going through training for Care and Community Ambassadors, which are our eighth graders getting leadership training and developing their leadership skills to support their peers. So those are a couple programs around our whole child that we continue to look at, and new programs that we're starting up, often driven by the interests of our students.
And just to piggyback off of what Winton said, the consistency in the goals also allows for consistency across the six buildings. And just hearing the elementary principals share their presentation and then working with Winton on this presentation, it's clear that we're all working on what's best for students, particularly around RTI. And at the high school level, we've had the DICs, the Department Instructional Centers, for years. And one of the things that we recently discovered was that students were struggling to get into the DICs because there were students, many of the seats were being taken up by students taking makeup tests or taking a test for a teacher. So last year, working with the department chairs, we piloted the idea, we piloted a building-wide testing center. So if a student has to make up a test, or if they have and they receive accommodations when they take assessments, they take their test at the test center. And what that has allowed is for us to refocus the DICs back to what their intention is, what that initial intention was, for students to be able to drop in and get tier two level support. Our tier three support has not changed in the sense that it's still through the ASC, through the Academic Support Center, but looking at the success that the elementary schools have had with their flexible and fluid model, we decided to, could we take some pieces of that and implement that at the high school and really make it tailored to the high school level. So students still are assigned to the Academic Support Center if they need tier three support, but now they have individual goals, and those goals have been created by sometimes the student themselves in collaboration with their teachers or their counselor or their administrator. And students work on those goals are reviewed and monitored. And once a student has met those goals, then the student does not go to the ASC anymore and another student takes their place. So really taking what's working at the elementary level and making it fit at the high school. As Winton mentioned, we continue to work on our curriculum and our common assessments, building that guaranteed and viable curriculum. This year, our focus is still Common Core in the math department. This year, it's Pre-Calc that is implementing the Common Core, as well as a priority with the new social studies framework. In terms of common assessments, the elementary and middle schools have been working on aligning their assessments in the 12-1-1 program with those in the general education program, and now that has worked its way up to the high school, and that's where we're focusing with our common assessments. And as Winton mentioned, the development of the whole student, we have some amazing programs that are continuing as well as starting this year at the high school in terms of development of the whole student. Sources of strength, I think you've heard me and Dr. Putnam talk about sources of strength. It is a program that it's a suicide prevention and anti-bullying program that trains students who are natural leaders on how to be peer leaders to provide support and positive influence to their peers. And we had a training last week for 45 students and about 11 adult advisors, and we had trained about the same in the spring. And hopefully this spring we'll be able to train some more students. So the Sources of Strength program really, and you'll see throughout the building Sources of Strength posters and different messages that Sources of Strength has sponsored. And it's really just using the students to build a positive culture. The Student Summit on Race, I think Dr. Putnam has shared with you some information and some exciting news that we have related to that. But the Student Summit on Race last year started in West Irondequoit. They brought in some students from Ferguson, Missouri, and just started the conversation, invited schools across the area. It started with about 175 students and 15 high schools. And we actually have a Student Summit on Race this week on Friday in Greece, and we are up to 300 students from over 35 high schools in the county. And it's students coming together to talk about racial issues and how they can positively influence and make change in their community. And it's very empowering for students. I'll be taking 7 students with me this week. Those students are very excited. We will be offering showings of the documentary I Am Not a Racist, Am I? In January. We are partnering with West Irondequoit, Pittsford, and Fairport. And so that will be really exciting. It's a documentary that has facilitated discussion built into it, and we're actually going to take the recommendation from Irondequoit and have some of our students trained as facilitators. So the students cannot wait for that. It's coming up first part of January. And then, as you have probably heard, we redesigned freshman orientation, and this actually came out of some feedback from students related to Moving Up Day at Bay Trail. They said Moving Up Day is so exciting and so much fun, and can we make freshman orientation as fun? So we took some of their feedback, we developed a workshop model, and students were grouped with their counselor, and they traveled with their counselor doing multiple activities. There was a scavenger hunt so that they could learn the building. There was sources of strength activities. This allowed them to interact and get to know some students that may not have been in their house at Bay Trail. They got their first grilled bagel experience. They got a t-shirt so that they all had t-shirts for homecoming. And it was great because it was the day before school started. Staff was here. We were able to do a big welcome. The feedback from students and families, teachers, counselors has all been very positive. So we hope to kind of tweak that as for next year. And then resiliency programming and freshman seminars. The counselors and health teachers have been working together to deliver specific content or curricula during freshman seminars. So they've started very small with four topics: stress management, appropriate use of social media, drug use and prevention, and then suicide and depression. And they're using different models to deliver that curricula, guest speakers. They're doing some hands-on stuff and just really working to ensure that all ninth graders hear the same message, because not all ninth graders are in Health One and are hearing that message, and we want to ensure that that those messages are coming across. And then I'll talk a little bit more about our Alt Ed program, because it fits well under both this goal and goal two. But we partnered with Gananda to offer an alternative education program, and we went for it and have built this program. It's a wonderful program. It allows us to deliver general education programming in a smaller setting for students who struggle in the large setting here at PHS.
As we look at our partnership goals at Bay Trail, it's really continuing. We're continuing to look at those transitions. What are students experiencing at Bay Trail? How are we gathering that data, and how are we sharing it with the high school? And so it's data on everything from not only their academic data, but also the social emotional data. The students that are seeing their counselors, the students that have different concerns, that have had different interventions, what's been successful, what's worked, and what hasn't, so that as those students transition to the high school staff doesn't have to repeat those experiences that we've been through, and they can take that and build off of that. So we're looking, that partnership part is using Infinite Campus to gather that data and communicate it in a way that can be useful to the high school as students get there. And as well, on the other side for us, talking with our elementary colleagues about the data we get for the students coming in, so we can make accurate placements for our house placements, for academic supports for students, as well as acceleration options for math as they come into sixth grade. Our partnerships with parents, continuing the partnerships we have, but also expanding that. Last spring, we started the Bay Trail Technology Committee. We have parents serving on that, and that group is looking at our parent communication regarding technology use and supports for parents around technology. They're revising the chart we have on our website of the apps and things that middle school students are using. We hope to get that up after Thanksgiving. And communicate that back out to parents. It continues to evolve, it continues to change. I saw a draft of that the other day. Some of them are the same. There's some new ones on there, and I had to go look those up because I'm not in the committee meetings. John Burke and Nicole Whitehead are leading that committee. And so we continue to look for ways for parents to be involved in our conversations in at Bay Trail and in the experience their kids are having at Bay Trail. We also now have the Bay Trail Twitter feed up on our Bay Trail webpage and are doing regular posts to that. So communicating what's going on in the building with our parents and helping them see those things. Not every middle school kid goes home and says, oh, let me tell you what I learned today. So the more we can help parents see some of those experiences of what's going on to help give them some talking points with their kids, the Twitter feed's a way we're looking to do that. And as we work through the rollout with Office 365 with staff as well as with students, that's going to further increase that ability for us to have that homeschool partnership and use some consistent tools and alleviate some of the struggles we have occasionally with different software versions and things like that, that will help with that process as well.
And at the high school, we've taken the partnerships and we've looked at them. We've really kind of separated them into partnerships across the Penfield School District and partnerships within the community. And across the school district, I know that Charlotte, as a student council member, has shared with you many of these but it's really building that K-12 connection and incorporating more events that connect us together. The Homecoming Carnival, we continue to tweak it and build it. It started very small in the cafeteria, and this year, you probably saw the flyer. We grew it, and we got great response, and we'd like to continue to work on that, as well as Blue Ribbon Week, started by the high school Cool to Be Kind Club, and now we have transitioned it to all the buildings. And the graduation parades, the elementary principals talked about the graduation parades, and what a great experience for not only the students but for the teachers as well, to see how those students have turned out and where they're going. These types of events are important for students, families, and staff to see all of us on the same page and to see us all united and really build that Team Penfield philosophy. And it really hit me. I think I may have shared with you last year during a student council meeting, one of my first years, a student said, "Dr. Maloney, we're all patriots, but we don't really feel like a patriot until we get to high school." And so that's where a lot of this work has come from with our student council. So that being said, homecoming, we are implementing a district-wide homecoming committee to help connect all the levels to the week. We are all patriots. For example, the dress-up days. The dress-up days often make a lot of sense for us here at the high school, but at the elementary level, it's not as easy to pull together Tacky Tourist Day. It's a little easier to do Crazy Sock Day. So working together to make sure that those events really do transcend across the K-12. We started this year very small with the flyer and inviting all of the families, and then we also sold the homecoming t-shirts K-12 and had a great response. So now I think we're ready to go big. And then Winton and I continue to work together to continue to strengthen that eighth grade transition. We started a few years ago with very specific counselor-to-counselor meetings to talk about and identify student needs to help with that transition. And as we continue to tweak those specific meetings and discussions, this year we're transitioning to discussions around program. For example, the eighth grade teachers who teach 12-1-1 recently invited the Penfield PHS teachers who teach 12-1-1 to come up and to discuss curricula and how that transition occurs. And then from within the community, as I mentioned, Sources of Strength is a partnership with the U of R and Senator Funke's office in terms of the funding. The Student Summit on Race, we hosted it last spring. Now we're part of the planning committee, and I recently took some students to Greece to help plan, and we're very excited for Friday to get to see how this comes together with 35 high schools. And the alternative education program with Gananda. Currently, it's a program for 9th and 10th graders. Last year, both districts, we got together. We both had a need for such a program. And Gananda had the space, and we said, let's build it. And it's been awesome to be a part of this process, because we have the control. And so we have really been able to design it. And when I say that, control from a programming perspective, from a staffing perspective. Currently, there are 12 students in the program, 7 from Penfield, 5 from Gananda. There are 3 teachers and 1 program coordinator. We're looking to grow the program for next year, looking to grow it both out and up. So it would continue on to 11th grade, as well as open up more seats for students in 9th and 10th grade. Not necessarily from Gananda or from Penfield, but from other neighboring districts who would like to come into the partnership. Students that go there, they take their core subjects there, PE and also an elective, and then they come back to PHS. It was important for us that they still have that connection at PHS, so they come back to PHS and have a class here at PHS to maintain that connection. And students are being very successful academically. The program, it's an awesome program. The students have come together. They want to pitch. They've named the program and have an idea for a mascot. So I'm really excited to hear what that is. And then we continue to work towards a career and technical education accreditation. And I have to say thank you, thank you, thank you for the business teacher. She has just been, it's like the stars aligned. She has just been so instrumental to our program. And through her work, our first step is going to be offering an internship in a co-op, two separate courses with work study. So what that means is students will be able to earn credit towards graduation through their own part-time jobs or through internships within the community. And we're really excited about that. Right now, students are currently taking an interest survey so that we can determine how many students are going to be interested in that program so that we can begin to work on that piece. In the interim, though, we have a committee that is coordinating a career day at PHS. This is all teacher-led, teacher-initiated. One of our chemistry teachers went to a phenomenal workshop over 2 weeks this summer, and she came back and she said, can we do this? And yeah, let's make it happen. So we're really excited. It's going to be held in the spring, and we'll get you more information as we pull all that together. So as Wynn and I sat down to work on the presentation and we looked at goal three, we realized that a lot of our goals for goal three were very similar in terms of aligning the staffing to support our RTI initiatives, as those are initiatives for both of us under goal one. They also align in terms of goal three. And then ongoing review of the building and instructional budgets for that efficiency and the focus on the instructional needs for students. We continue to review staffing, supply procurement, and maximizing state aid available for in multiple areas, whether it be professional development, textbook, and supporting the arts. And then, as Winton mentioned, that electronic communication, whether it be Infinite Campus, School Messenger, Office 365, we're very fortunate to have those tools right at our fingertips and be able to share that. And then the Twitter, we're both getting we're not as good. I'll admit we're not as good as the elementary principals, but we're getting there. We're working on it.
Okay. Well, that's a lot. it's great, though. It's really outstanding. What I was thinking of in that pause was last Wednesday at the Monroe County School Boards Association, we had a large presentation by three of the key leaders of the Summit on Race movement, and I don't think anyone else was there. I think I was the only one there, but Penfield High School and its staff and our district were highlighted several times as a leader in that movement, and by each of the three gentlemen that spoke. So I think it's just a great comment to hear that, and of course they talked about the same things you were talking about, and 300 students coming to the next one, and it Brockport too, there's one, or is that
the one this week is in Greece, and then in the spring it's in the city, and then next spring I think it's in Brockport.
They were booked in the 2018.
Oh yeah, they're booking.
Yeah, which is amazing considering we all know how it started. So thank you for that. Board members, questions?
I have a question.
Okay.
I should have prepared, sorry. With the implementation of the alternative ed in Gananda, is there a cost associated with that?
Yes. Okay. Last year, when we budgeted for this year, we budgeted that money through BOCES for the BOCES Alt-Ed program. And what we found was BOCES was struggling in a number of ways to provide the service to us that they felt was really valuable and effective. And so what we've done is that this program is also being run through a COSER with BOCES. So the funds were allocated for a program that would have taken place at BOCES. It's mm-hmm. now just going to take place at Gananda. Okay. So we did budget for it, but it is a similar cost to what we allocated for the Alt-Ed program that was at BOCES last year.
Okay, thank you for that. I have another question. You want to expand it to the junior year as well, but is there a purpose to not include seniors because of the high school experience, or do you foresee it going into senior year as well?
I think it could potentially go into senior year. No, the idea was that we would start this year with 9th and 10th and then grow up into 11th, then the following year 12th, okay, and grow out as well.
Yeah.
One of the pieces that we're working around is in terms of if students in the program would like to attend EMCC, how will we make that work? Mm-hmm. And so there's still lots of questions that we have that we need to figure out the nuts and the bolts around. But it's very exciting.
Yeah, it is. And these things tend to evolve anyway. You take one step, right, and it leads to another. That's great. Thank you.
Lisa.
I sort of have a follow-up question. I'm confused what this program does. Like, how does that, if you say it's a smaller kind of section of Gen Ed, which to me is sort of similar to a 12-1-1 program, except the pace might be different. So can you just explain, like, what that looks like?
So instead of having traditional class, 9 periods all day, their classes, they still have class periods, but they're a little more looser. The size is much smaller, so they can do things a little more creative and not have some of the structure that we have here. For example, on Fridays, they do, they bring food and they cook and they build it into a lesson and they teach some character skills and some math and they work together, really. And it's building a team, and these students have really struggled with that connection to school, and this, they're feeling connected and they're being successful. And it's just a non-traditional approach to the same algebra, living environment, the same courses we have here, just a different approach.
Other questions at all? Carol.
Not really a question, more like a comment. I so appreciate everything you're doing and all the programs. You know, hearing last meeting from the elementary schools, all the programs that we're familiar with, they are there. But now, you know, seeing that it's all expanding all the way to the high school, to 12th grade. And I so applaud our teachers and our students because they're embracing them. It's easy to say, you know, we want to start this program and maybe it's going to work, maybe it's not going to work, but seeing so many of them and such a great response, I think that is really great and speaks volumes about our students. I love the summit on race. So important right now. So, you know,
important.
That is great that, you know, we're championing this and going with it. So a lot of thanks for everything going on in your buildings.
Thank you.
And the videotape they showed, we saw Dr. Putnam's back at the videotape, and you were in it.
It wasn't when he was singing, because he sang.
Might be a video of me singing.
There was no sound, fortunately, in that. Just one more comment on the alternate high school, because I had close friends who's had a 12th grader that went into that at Victor. I don't know if you've studied their program, but it literally the small, the issue with the child was he was smart, but he just didn't want to go to school.
Right.
And so it just helped him tremendously. And then we went to the graduation. At the graduation, the head of the program had made a CD for every one of the seniors, highlighting their success in that class. And those parents were just thrilled, I mean, because it really made a difference. So I'm sure you've talked to them, but it's just a great program.
What's, you know, I think it's important, you know, with Lisa's question, and that is that this program or something similar to this program has existed for Penfield through BOCES 1 for a long time. It was called World of Work. It has a lot of different names, the Alternative Learning Academy through General Ed. When that program wasn't meeting the needs anymore, we struggled for a couple of years on what to do with certain kids. And so, you know, Jim and Leslie worked with Gananda, and it's a great program. So it's one of the pieces is that while it's new because we have, for the first time, really some control over it. But it also sort of filled a void that that started to exist because BOCES wasn't offering the program anymore because other districts weren't sending students, and it's all about how many kids go so they can actually run a program similar to what we deal with class size. So again, it's great. And we're going to do a tour, we've talked about, of BOCES classrooms for the board, and I'd love to set one up with the Gananda campus as well. Having gotten out there, it really is. It's small, so we probably want to, we'll talk about it ahead of time and give them plenty of time, but we've talked about getting out there so you can see what it looks like as well.
Great.
Okay. Well, Winton and Leslie, thank you very much. And we just love hearing of what's going on and appreciate all your efforts. And thank you to the other principals in attendance as well. We appreciate it. Well,
thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you to the community for their support as well.
Thank you. Thanks. This is when we're all going to turn our eyes and please go enjoy your night. Yes. So I love that you're here, but I also, there's lots of other things to do. Thank you. Nope, we're good.
We're good.
Thank
you. Okay. So visitor speaking time. Time is provided on our agenda for residents to bring concerns and comments to the board. Comments should not be related to any particular individual or to specifics of negotiations, since it's not proper for the board to discuss these issues in public session. Now, we do have a request to speak comment form that would be filled out and handed to the district clerk. And it's expected the speakers will limit their comments to 5 minutes or less, and the board reserves the right to limit the total amount of time spent on the citizens' comment period. Written communication to the board is encouraged as well. And tonight, I'd like to welcome back Krista Knack from Special Ed PTA. Krista has been a frequent visitor to us, and we appreciate you taking the time to do it and coming to talk to us.
Yes, so thank you. And it does not seem possible. Like, I swear I was just in this seat 10 days ago, but apparently a year has gone by. It is book fair time again. So if you don't have it on your calendars already, December 3rd, all day at Webster Barnes & Noble. What I'm going to pass out, we started... See, I had too much time to get organized. Now, what did I do with it all? We started a poster contest 2 years ago. So the winner of the poster contest gets their picture on the flyer. Okay. I have it. I know I have it. So what I want to pass out is the color version of that. Or in the interest of time, it'll be the black and white version of that. So
so this is this year's winner. So this will go on all the flyers handed out. And I'm also going to hand out the other flyers that we have so far as the advertising, the poster contest, as well as our visiting author. So we are doing the poster contest again. And again, judging is done right at Barnes & Noble. So pick your favorite poster, and you're going to see it on the flyer, hopefully in color next year. Oh, darn it all, here it is. Anyways, visiting authors. So this year we have Mary Jane and Herm Ouch. It's a husband-wife team, and they're going to come in from noon to 3:30, and they're going to do book signing. They've done books, one of them called The One-Handed Catch, which I believe is inspired by Herm Ouch, who I believe has the use of one arm. So it kind of ties in nicely to what we're doing as far as disability awareness. We have our elementary principals coming back to read again. So I'm bummed our new ones took off. So they do know about the friendly competition. We did tell them about that. So last year's winner was Indian Landing for the first time. We've got music coming from Indian Landing. The Indian Landing singers will be back. Harris Hill string students will be back. Shelby Sponholz will be doing yoga. Let's see, the therapy dogs will be back. Bay Trail Advanced Chamber Orchestra will be back. Music Education Center has also signed up, along with Jumbo Shrimp. So we're still kind of putting the schedule together, still putting things in order. We just had, as we partner with Webster Barnes & Noble, the gentleman there that we work with sent us two authors that they were trying to set something up earlier in the summer, and it fell through. So hopefully we're going to get both of those authors to come on our day, and both of the authors have books dealing with anxiety and depression. So one of which is Jody Amon, and I don't have the name of the other one yet because she hasn't gotten back to me. So I'm hoping that we'll be able to have them come and also have them speak a little bit. Am I missing anything? We're going to collect the artwork from all of the buildings, you know, have that kind of decorate the walls. You know, it's a fun day. It's a long day, but it's a labor of love for all of us. So Luckily, I've again got a great team this year, and we're moving forward. So if you don't know, all proceeds go towards purchasing books for the Penfield School District libraries, as well as funding scholarships for high school seniors. So questions?
Any questions, board members? Well, it's been an outstanding event. Oh, go ahead, Barb.
I will be out of town on that Saturday, but does it go for the whole week again?
Yes. So okay. If you just, there is a voucher attached to bring the voucher up to the register. We get a percentage of voucher sales. If you happen to lose your voucher, just say you're with the Penfield SEPTA Book Fair, and we will get the credit. So, yes, you could shop during that week. And you could shop online, but I think the percentage is a little bit lower. So if you can go to the store. However, if you have out-of-town relatives.
Cool. That's a great idea. All right. Well, we've got it in the calendars. It's a great event if anybody hasn't been there. And we look forward to another successful event. And the dogs are just amazing, too. I mean, that's just the therapy dogs are incredible, too.
They're a huge hit. And the kids are used to seeing them in the library, so it's nice.
That's great. Well, thank you again for joining us and keeping us up to date on all your great stuff.
Oh, and the purpose was also to invite everybody to come, obviously. So if that didn't come out loud and clear.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thanks. Okay. Our student representative, Charlotte Nazarian. You have a kind of an interesting scarf on there. Holding up your arm, is there a story behind it, or you don't want to go into it with us?
Well, the sling clashed with my dress, so I had to put a scarf over it.
Okay.
No, I broke my arm in gym class this morning.
Oh.
So. But I got an A, so it's all good.
She is an overachiever. There's no doubt about it.
She's so good, she won't mention it. And then this morning that happened, and when were you back in school?
Seventh period.
And here today. So you really is a dedicated Penfield student and a board member, so board representative.
I'd stay home. Yeah, I'd be home. So the district has been pretty busy these past 2 weeks. Harris Hill collected 841 boxes of stuffing for the Penfield Ecumenical Food Shelf. They had a successful Veterans Day assembly and actually had a World War II veteran. They held a mock election, and I actually had the chance to visit Harris Hill today. And as I was told yesterday, the votes were still being counted, but I got an insight that Hillary Clinton won the Harris Hill election. And the first LEGO League team won first place at regional competition two Saturdays ago. Cobbles held a bingo night on the 4th of November. They hosted America Recycles Day today. And students are being asked to gear up for winter weather with their Fab Five. Indian Landing also had a Veterans Day assembly, including fifth grade students learning about different parts of the military. They had a Marine Corps Purple Heart recipient at the assembly. Clinton won their mock election for president, and pizza won favorite food. Power Panthers' first LEGO team won the Rising Star Award during their competition. Bay Trail, as Mr. Buddington had mentioned, hosted Mix It Up and Make a Difference Day during lunches. Their first LEGO League team, Millennium Falcons, won prizes in robot performance and robot design. It's very cool to see all the first LEGO League teams doing well because our high school program is terrific. Bay Trail also held a mock election. They have not called the race yet. Penfield High School, Almost Maine, is this weekend, 17th, 18th, 19th. You can purchase tickets in the library or on brownpapertickets.com. Our lock-in was wildly successful. Thank you to everyone who helped make it a great night. The custodial staff they went over the top helping us. We had around 175 participants. We had to send everyone home by midnight, but I was up till 3:30. Model UN had four best delegates, and Mira Phillips, who is a junior, was named secretariat. And the ceramics class held a raku firing, which is a way to make cool designs on the pottery. Now the athletics. Both boys and girls volleyball teams are sectional champions, regional champions, and now head into state finals. Boys cross country won sectionals, came in sixth at states, and is headed to federations this weekend. Tony Naccarella, who's a junior, was a sectional champion in the 100-yard free for swimming, followed second by her teammate Serafina Viola, who is a freshman. Tony, as well as a relay team, will be heading to states. Coach Weber, who is the varsity swimming coach, received Section 5's Coach of the Year, and today, after I wrote this, Pete Chambo, the athletic director, was awarded something very important that I'm totally blanking on the name of right now. But he got...
You're going to put me on the spot. Nancy, do you remember?
It's a Distinguished Service Award. It's a national award.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. I read a little article, like 1 of 10 people get it.
Ten people each year get it, athletic directors, and I just read it before I came in, too, because it was just announced.
Yeah.
So it is, I think, the top story on our webpage if the board would like to go and take a look. So
it's
thank you.
Very cool. Mr. Shamble's a great guy. And winter sports are gearing up, and we're looking to add to this year's brick collection. And that's a wrap.
That's great.
It's a sling.
Great.
I will share just because of Cobbles, because the one that I'm sure they didn't give you, but they also had an election.
Okay, it was not on their Twitter page.
Clinton won that election.
Okay, she won the high school one too.
And they also had a Veterans Day celebration. The only reason I know that is because I attend, because my father is a Vietnam vet, and they drive into town for that every year. So all the elementary school principals who want me there know that I'm at Cobbles for at least another couple years, and then I'm a free agent. So
then they start ponying up bribes, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yep. Any questions? Well, as usual, great report, and looks like the youth of America have it going for them when it comes to voting. So, you know, they just took an interest and they got at it, and I think that's just a great example of democracy. So thanks again for everything, and I hope you feel better. Feel free to leave any time now. Oh, okay.
But the,
you want to raise your arm, too? All right. Anyways, thank you again. And we'll go on to the superintendent reports.
Yes. The other way, both my arms work pretty well. So I'm hoping no surgeries for me. But I know. I probably did. And again, Charlotte does a great job. So I think I got some things that she didn't get, which I always, now it's like a game to make sure that I have a couple. What's that? That is really good.
Boy, this is scary.
That's pretty good, though. I'm starting to get worried for my own job now with Charlotte down there. So. So student and staff updates, we've got some great things. National Honor Society induction, just a congratulations to the following PHS students who were inducted into the National Honor Society at the fall induction ceremony. Josh Anderson, Pramiti Data, did I say that? What is it? Pramati Data. Mike Gorman, Maria Moore, Emily Vanderbilt, and Dana Wakeman. And this is a very small group, you can tell, because the large National Honor Society induction takes place in the spring for this year, and then these students have an opportunity. And I was able to go to that. It was a small ceremony, but really, really nice, and kids were very excited, and the existing members of NHS invited them in, but just some really great kids. Rochester Philharmonic Youth Orchestra, following Penfield High School students have been selected as members for the 2016-17 Rochester Philharmonic Youth Orchestra. June Barton, Sarah Chen, Pramati Data. I'm gonna go see her tomorrow and apologize. Elaine Grace, Claire Go, Jasmine Kylie, Gregory Moon, Kristen Nell, Nalzek, and Joy Zhang. Charlotte, you really are good. You are. Thank you. That's all right. I appreciate it. Again, I feel like we do this every board meeting, but it is just a huge testament to our music program in Penfield and the students and the support that we provide. The Hochstein Youth Orchestra, congratulations to Penfield High School students, Alina Chadwick, Maria Moore, Justin Moranti, Nicole Page, and Mitch Siegel, who I'm being selected for the 2016-17 Hochstein Youth Sympathy Orchestra. And not only can I struggle with names, I also can't play any instruments. So whenever I see this, I'm just absolutely amazed at the talent of our Penfield students. Athlete signing day was very exciting. If you hit social media, please do and take a look at some great photos of our students who celebrated signing for many colleges across the nation. So girls lacrosse is Megan Makowski heading to Hofstra. Emily Goebel going to SUNY Cortland, go Red Dragons. Madison Korakin, who's going to Hofstra University. Alyssa Sproul going to Niagara University. Lindsay Hernati going to SUNY Geneseo. For boys lacrosse, Cody Calvert, Ohio Northern. Brady DeHaan, Canisius College, Peter Schwab going to the University at Albany, Andrew Powlin, RIT, Adam Witschaber going to RIT, girls volleyball, Aaliyah Stegerwald going to Fairfield University, Johanna Gregory going to Gannon University, and Emily Harnischweger going to Carson Newman University. In girls track is Abby Frank heading to Quinnipiac University. So just, I love that because it's great names, it's great athletes, they're great students. You've heard their names before when we've presented over the last 4 years, and now they're heading off to some great schools. Very exciting. So there are some photos of athlete signing day. Congratulations to all of our athletes. This is a reminder, last year in the spring, we did the PSA campaign for Stop DWI. It's the high school film class, and for 3 years in a row, we've locked up the prizes. Our Penfield High School kids do really well, and we just got word now that the winning public service announcement created by PHS students is running throughout the day. It started yesterday on the 14th through November 27th on Channel 13, 16, and Fox 7, and I did send a list out to you. Saw it, Barb saw it.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So it's
yep.
It's great that people from all over the area are watching one of our own students' films. Yesterday I had an opportunity to head over to the high school and watched a presentation on healthy eating and proper nutrition for practice and game days, which was delivered to the boys' hockey team by our very own director of food service, Joey Argento. And just wanted to say many thanks to both Joey Argento and our boys' hockey coach, Nate Miller, for their partnership in educating the whole student. They had about an hour and a half presentation. One of the things they've noticed, and it's sort of something we hope that other sports teams take over, is that hockey practices in the evening because we have to go to the ice rink. We use Webster. And many times the kids were coming in with fast food. They have school, they have homework, and then they just run out, grab fast food, and come to practice. And so this was a program proactive to say, what do we do to help students understand the necessity of what to eat? So Joey did a great overview of really the differences with protein and carbohydrates and complex carbs and really what it does and why those choices are important. And then they brought them into the cafeteria and they actually worked together to make samples of some protein smoothies, some healthy eating sandwiches, really quick things you can make. It's something that I looked at and said, I wish 20 and 30-year-old Tom knew that because I would have been a lot better and choices. So it was really, really great. And they have some proactive things trying to get the kids now to follow through with that. They have sort of a reward system, which is great. But I thought it was a great partnership. One of our goals here amongst our food service, who oversees lunches and breakfast, working with hockey teams, because both Joey and Nate, I believe, were former hockey players, so in their high school heyday. So it's a great opportunity to sort of give back and showcase that partnership, as well as the focus is it's not just winning on the hockey ice, but it's about making good, healthy choices from there on out when it comes to eating. So I really love that concept and wanted to share with the board. And then today, last but definitely not least, is School-Related Professionals Day. Just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge the contributions of our school-related professionals and what they do to help educate the whole student. This really is just about every job class besides the classroom teacher. Just a lot of great opportunity to thank those amazing people. We have some stuff up on social media as well. And just wanted to, again, take an opportunity to say thank you to the community and to the board for our amazing school-related professionals. And that was the first time that Charlotte and I did not have any conflicting statements. So that was a great job. Thank you for helping me out. That's all I have. I'll turn it over to Mark for goals, assumptions, and guidelines.
Thanks. We have a brief update tonight of goals, assumptions, and guidelines. So this was presented much more in depth at a previous board meeting, but we before the board adopts, it's on your agenda to adopt tonight this year's goals. We get one last chance to make some updates to them. I want to point out what changes have been made as a result of some new information that we've gotten or any comments that we had on the previous set of goals. And also it's time in our calendar for enrollment projections. You heard tonight at tonight's presentation instructional reports from the instructional staff, the secondary staff, around your board goals and their progress towards them. So certainly this presentation is about that as well, focused, of course, more on fiscal responsibility, the third of your goals, with a more specific budget goal, so that we'll continue our commitment to long-range financial planning, balancing the needs of all students, maintaining programs, and minimizing the impact on taxpayers. So those three prongs of that budget goal have been in place for a number of years. That's important to us, and it's really the lodestar that we set our compass to. So with that, on tonight's calendar is review of those enrollment projections as we look forward into the process and further into the future in terms of long range we project out for 5 years, with an eye towards what does this mean for us. And again, we'll review and approve those goals. So with regard to, you have a much more comprehensive enrollment report in your packet. So this is not intended to take the place of that, but really just kind of hit the highlights. And we always begin with, well, how did we do? I mean, if we're projecting enrollment, how well did we do last year? So the first column on this chart, on this spreadsheet, is 15-16 actual. So last year, we had in our schools 4,459 students. We projected the next column 4,484. That's a growth of 25 students. So last year at this time, when I was sitting here, we thought we would grow by about 25 kids. We grew by 69. And so the last column over is where the difference is. Where were those misses? And you can see we're very accurate, almost dead on in middle school and at the high school, a little bit under 9 kids, but in a 4,000 student numerator, that's really not much of a miss, but relatively more at the elementary school. So we missed by 16 kids overall at the kindergarten level and by 41 students at the grades 1 through 5. Again, that's not a lot. It's not a lot of kids when you realize that it's spread out over 4 buildings and many, many sections. But it's more than we've missed by in the past. And so I think that's interesting. And what does that mean? I mean, that's the reason that we look backwards, is what does that inform us about our enrollment projections, about our district, and about our future as we look forward. And essentially, I think what it is doing is confirming what we've been talking about for the last few years. We have been in a very steady state, as have many, many in Monroe County districts, of enrollment decline for many years. That was pretty steady and fairly predictable. But what's happened over the course of the last couple years, and we've been talking about this, is it seems to have leveled out. For the last few years, our enrollment projections have indicated much smaller reductions, and I think what's happening is that curve is beginning to bend. We saw it a little bit last year. We started to see growth in our elementary schools last year, and now we're seeing it in an accelerating rate, and it's coming at the elementary schools, which makes sense, I think, into this year. So how'd we do? Well, 5 years ago, when we looked forward, again, the model depends on history, so it assumes it can't predict changes. It can't predict changes in demographics. It can't predict changes in the. It can't predict necessarily changes in the. In the reputation of our school district. It predicts based on history, and so 5 years ago, in the height of that, in the height of sort of the declining years, we projected. In 2011, that for this year we would have 1,912 kids in the elementary schools. We have 2,000, just over 2,000. So we're at about 93% accuracy. If you remember this chart from last year, we were 98% accuracy. So we're getting less accurate at the elementary school. That's consistent, I think, with what's going on. We're still pretty much dead on at the middle school and the high school. So what does that mean for our future? This is the projection of the go-forward year. So again, it repeats 15, 16, 16, 17. It's the same layout, but here you can see what the percent changes were. So at kindergarten, our kindergarten enrollment in 15, 16 was 318 kids as of beds day, 341 this year. We grew by 7% at the kindergarten level, by 3% at grades 1 through 5, and we're about flat middle and high school. So what does our projection model say going forward? It projects that we fall back a little bit to 327 students coming into kindergarten. I'll talk about that a little bit more in just a second. That we grow by about 3% in grades K 1 through 5, that's consistent with last year. So that we're going to continue to grow at about that 3% rate in first through fifth grade. That's really two things. Bigger incoming first grade class sizes than we would have otherwise sort of expected, and continued growth in kindergarten. Our incoming kindergarten classes have been bigger than what we've experienced in the past, and they're working their way through the system now. If you start out bigger at kindergarten, it's bigger at first grade, it stays bigger at third grade, and second grade, and third grade, and so on. So we'll continue to see that growth. But why does it decline from last year at kindergarten? That's the real question. I don't want to take you on too deep a dive, but Paige, if you would look at your enrollment projection report, which is in your packet on page, let's see, it is page, let me see, I think we, page 13 of the report, what you see is that next year, 20 was the 2012 birth year. And the 2012 birth year was the smallest in Monroe County. About 8,200 students were born in that particular year. And we project in part based on part of our projection models based on how many kids were, I mean, how many kids are there? Certainly they can come from somewhere else, but how many kids were born in Monroe County 5 years ago that might now be coming to kindergarten? A portion of those will come in Penfield. And as you can see, 2012 was a very small birth year. So there's two things going on in this model. I think next year, absent anything else, we would expect to see a smaller class size coming in just based on the births. But we know there's something else going on in the data because we've been missing. I already adjust our model at kindergarten by an additional 4% based on sort of historical trends after we switched to full day kindergarten. It may be that that's not enough. We had started out adjusting at 10%, and I backed off as we got more experience with full day K. Maybe 4% isn't quite enough. We won't really know until we get a few more years of history under our belt with regard to this. But the model served well for us. I think we're gonna continue to use it as our guidance. And at this point, based on what we know, and it's beginning to pick up more and more years every year of this increased history. So based on that, we're going to expect 327. I have to tell you, I would not be, you know, absolutely shocked if it, and this also includes an adjustment for the first years of the new known developments that we know about. So we've adjusted for what we know, but we can't know what we don't know. And so we'll project forward, we'll see what happens. I wouldn't be horribly surprised, to be honest with you, if we didn't have another year of 341 kindergarten kids. The model doesn't project it, I don't know it, but just based on the way the data feels, which is not very scientific, it feels like we're really entering a phase of accelerating growth. So. It'll take a few years for that to build into the model and a few years of history for us to understand it. But if you look at the enrollment report, you'll see that it's projecting out when you look out 5 years, we're now projected to be 5% larger in terms of our student enrollment than we are today. So that's our forward looking. I think enrollment projecting is always a little bit of a You know, it is an estimation, which is a fancy way of saying you're guessing. It's an educated guess, right? We're doing the best we can with what we know. And I think the important thing is that we think about it, we look forward, and we adjust as we move on. And it's a good, and it is good news. I think many districts around the county are continuing to decline. Certainly, we're seeing some of our neighbors actually beginning the conversations about school closings and so on, and we're in a bit of a different place, I think. We'll talk a little bit more about the challenges that are going to come with this as we move further on into the goals, assumptions, and guidelines. This is a part of that, though, so I thought before I moved on, are there any questions about this? Yes.
Carol.
So, because we were a little bit off in our projection, is it prudent to just expect just a 1.6% change? When I look at how much we were off between first grade and fifth grade, I mean, 47 students, you know, I know they don't come in little neat packages of first graders for this building, thankfully, because that's two classrooms and more in for one building. So I'm glad that they're kind of spread out.
Right, and they are in fact spread out to the grades and the buildings.
So is it irresponsible of us to expect more than 1.6%?
So then how much do we expect? See, that's the you know, we have to trust our model, I think, is sort of the message I would bear. We grew by one point, we missed, and with the miss last year, including the miss, we grew by 1.5. And we're projecting 1.6. So upon what basis would we choose some other number? You know, we could choose 3, but then what's our rationale for that?
Well, we already have constructions.
Sure, and that, but so. We've built that in as best we can. You know, we've built in projections for the, we've built in, the model includes an adjustment for the new construction. We include a little bit of, we include an adjustment for sort of the unknown, the increased growth that we've seen since the implementation of full day K, and we're including what we know about the underlying kindergarten sections, or the underlying birth rate. So we've taken all the things we know, and we've tried to take those into account. There's always going to be an unknown, but I wouldn't be able to pick a number that I could recommend to you to say this is what I would use instead, because I wouldn't have a rationale to support it. Is it possible that this is wrong? Of course it's always possible, but it is the best estimate that we have at this time.
I guess maybe my question does not have an answer, but I'm wondering, is it more reasonable to say we're going to have more than 1.6% and then later to say, okay, well, I guess we only had 1.6% or 1.7, or is it better to say, yeah, we're going to keep it at 1.6, but then later on to say, sorry, ladies and gentlemen, we didn't have that accurate of prediction. It's
sure,
much more than
I think
this,
it depends
which
on
is better.
It, well, I think it depends. I would recommend this, but I also know that we, in terms of all, it's not on tonight's PowerPoint, but if you'll remember a couple meetings ago when we looked at the first round of goals, we're planning on 4 sections at each building. Our budget planning will include 4 sections at each building of incoming kindergarten. That's more than enough to accommodate. That accommodated this year's 341 kids, and if you'll recall, at Harris Hill, we only ended up with 3 sections. So in our planning, we had accommodated for any reasonable miss. And did it get tighter at grades 1 through 5? Yes, absolutely. But we were able to manage that as well. And don't forget, at 1 through 5, that growth came not particularly at any one school. It came mostly at 2 schools, but we're spreading all of our changes out across 20 sections of elementary school. So there's 4 sections at 5 grade levels in each of the buildings, approximately. So, you know, I think it's important not to overreact about the 40 kids. It's important to keep track of. It is important. But I don't think it should that we should try and, you know, change our planning process around it. We've built in an accommodation. We pay attention to kindergarten, and particularly at kindergarten and first grade. We know that that's always historically been very difficult to project. So we pay, this isn't the only time we do this. We spend a lot of time as we move into the spring and summer looking at those enrollment projections, and we'll adjust sections. And we've planned on being able to adjust those sections depending on what comes about. This is a point in time where we're making our best estimate about what our future holds. And then we're going to pay attention and adjust as we go along. Because we know we're probably wrong somewhere in this, right? That's just how it works.
All right. Thank you, Mark.
Mark?
You know, I think you explained a lot of what I had to ask for Carol's question, because really the target here where the biggest impact is that the entry in kindergarten. And you're looking at your five-year average of the percentage of county growth.
Correct.
At the same time, you look over 10 years, you see this 10-year trending going on beyond just the five-year average. So again, is it time to look at a parallel, to test out a parallel theory in terms of how you look at those numbers?
For years and years, I've been looking at, because it seems so intuitively correct to me that we would be able to use our the data that we have on fourth grade enrollments, our census data on fourth grade enrollments, or I'm sorry, fifth grade, four-year-old in, they're not in school yet, so they're not, four-year-olds to predict incoming kindergarten. I mean, isn't that, we know they're out there, they're in our schools, we have names, we have addresses, we theoretically know who they are. But when I've looked at that in backwards over history, that census data has not done as good a job of prediction of the incoming kindergarten class size as the way we do it. So I've never switched, and in fact I quit including that comparison in the model in your report a few years ago because it just didn't seem predictive. I think what's important about that data to be able to be used is we have to be consistent about how we collect it. We have to collect it at the, you know, there's got to be, it's got to be very systematized to be predictive. And I think we're doing a better job on it. I continue to look at it because I would love to, it just seems so intuitively obvious to me. And when I looked at this year's report, last year's, that model would have predicted very closely where we came out. So I think I'm going to continue to look at it. I'd be happy to provide an estimate of that to the board, but I just don't feel like we're getting better at that routine, but I just don't think we're quite there yet.
So, and another question is, regardless of the prediction, of the accuracy prediction, we've got 327 projected. For kindergarten, you know, the purpose of this projection is, among other things, space and staffing.
Right.
And right now, one of our critical issues is space. So as we, if this goes, as this becomes an under estimation, are we able to accommodate this space if it ends up being more than we had thought?
We can accommodate the four sections, and certainly at 327, because we've got classes of four sections moving out from fifth into sixth grade. So, you know, if we pick up a fifth section along the way, which I think if this trend continues, inevitably we're going to, and we've had five section classes in recent memory, you know, then we'll feel that pinch, and we'll have to figure out a way to do that. In the short term, we certainly can't turn them away. So when that happens, what it's going to mean is to continue the trend that we're already on of eliminating a computer lab, converting space, moving people, you know, making the adjustments that we've had to already make. We'll just have to continue to make those. We've gone through an exercise with the principals at each of the buildings, so we know where the space is and where it isn't, and we have choices. They're not always as desirable as we would like, but we do know at this point where we'd be looking to create that space. So in the short term, this is the short-term problem. I think we've got it under control. It's a challenge, certainly, and it's going to cause you know, it's a pinch. It's going to cause squeaking. Class size is going to grow over the short term. And then over the long term, we're working towards our capital project in a few years that would add space at those elementaries. So we've got lots of things moving.
Thanks. Thank you.
Lisa.
Questions on this tonight. I'm curious if in the model, is there something about real estate and not new construction, but I'm guessing since it's pretty hot here the last summer or two, that could be why we have that bump in elementary schools.
The model picks that up based on the historical percentage, right? So although, again, it's all based on history. So there's no specific like annual adjustment that I could make. I wouldn't even imagine how to do doing that, because at some point it moves completely beyond a model where you're estimating to just making stuff up, and you know I don't, if I change my assumptions every year, it doesn't serve us well.
Right.
But as over time, as the market stays hot, and you know, I think one of the things that has is changing as Penfield as a school district continues to be, and our reputation as it increases and continues to and as our performance continues to look good in comparison to our peers, it's, you know, it drives the market. It really does. And I think that's a lot, that is part of what we're seeing here. I think that's part of it. I think the other part of it is we're just beginning to come out of, people are beginning to they're a little less hunkered down as we come out of the Great Recession, I think, and they're beginning to move, and you know, I think there's some of that going on. So we're certainly seeing some larger developments than we have in a couple of recent years. So, you know, I do feel like that is gradually beginning to change.
Camille.
I guess that's where what you were just talking about is sort of what I was would what maybe what we can maybe intuit, which is that the enrollment projections are not really matching birth rates so much as they're reflecting selection and choice, so that's why the modeling isn't working. So I hope this is a quick yes or no question. Is this uptick in enrollment also being seen in the three other highest performing school districts?
I don't know that.
Pittsburgh, Brighton, HFL.
I just don't know that.
You know, it'd be interesting to get a feeling for where they're coming from, what's happening. But
you know,
I would think we could get at that data, and it might be interesting.
That's a simple email. That's a yes or no question. Are you seeing an uptick? You know, I'd like to point out what this uptick looks like just in the data. So if you look at, again, that spreadsheet, we use a five-year average of our share of the Monroe County births. And if you look back into history, you can see, you know, this chart only shows back to 2002, but our share of that, if you will, is, you know, in 2002 was 3.52%. We got about 3%, 3.5% of the Monroe County births. And, you know, it's funny to think about it that way, but that percentage includes choice. It includes, it includes how many kids were born. It includes people moving in, people moving out. It's just a rough proxy of the way you do that. And you can see it's been as low as just under 3, but it floats around 3.1, 3.2, 3.3 throughout all the years until beginning in more recent history. It moves up to 3.6 and 3.7 and last year 4%. So, you know, that's a change. A five-year average then projecting forward at 3.7%. You know, if we project forward at 4% or 4.1%, the model looks different. It's more aggressive. You know, is that possible? Of course. But we've always used that five-year average, and as you can see, it sort of bumps around. So this model isn't designed around, and the changes that we're seeing aren't dramatic. We're not a Fort Drum with the military coming in and thousands of kids suddenly showing up. We're Penfield.
Or huge immigrant population, which has happened to some of the school districts we heard about at the convention.
Sure, absolutely. You know, our changes are important to us, and they're real. But they're not the kinds of dramatic swings that would make, you know, a five-year average unreasonable. So it's what we've always used, and it served us well in the past. There may come a time when we, if this continues to underpredict, we're going to do something different. We'll either say, well, do we need to shorten it up? Do we need to adjust in the short term? Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure 1 year of 40 kids is worth it at this, it, you know, would justify it at this point.
And when you get back to us on that data, can you also include which of those districts have full day K, which I think eventually that'll sort of flatten out, but that we, you know, you might get a bump in the years when you, if you have that and other districts don't, because I know all of them don't have that.
Right.
But I don't think people are necessarily choosing by that one factor, but it's a
piece
factor.
Of it, I think.
So just include that.
I don't believe Brighton or Pittsburgh
doesn't.
Do. And I know Brighton doesn't yet. They don't have space yet, so they're looking at construction.
I'm just saying, you know, there's a choice. You're looking at different districts. What do they each have?
Sure. Hmm. Anything else on that? So that's enrollment.
I just want to...
Oh, yeah, sure.
I'm sorry, I don't have a question. But I just, one of those pieces as having been in the district as an assistant principal and principal, I've sat at these tables or in that audience, and I'm always amazed at how spot on the methodology that Mark uses to come up with those numbers. Mm-hmm. And so looking through that board packet, I really encourage everyone to look through it because it outlines the methodology. So here's the U of R nerdy doctor in me, which is that's what we use, and it's really clearly defined and outlined. And so you want to be able to go back to that methodology so we can really do a comparison year to year. Because one of the pieces in listening to the questions is what we don't want is to just throw a dart at the board and say what our guess is. Because then it's sort of the methodology is right out the window. So a lot of work goes into it. So he never takes kudos. I'm going to give Mark kudos for this. Yep. Is that, you know, that what is always amazing is how close and spot on we are. This is it an enigma? Is it this 1 year? Is it going to always happen? So I think it's that great point you just mentioned, which is now we monitor over the next couple of years to see if something needs to change. And again, what we keep hearing is it's a positive in a tough situation that people are moving here with their families. So, and as Mark mentioned very nicely, we can't say no. So we'll find a spot. We'll educate, and it'll be a little tight, but we'll make it work. But I just wanted to say thank you, Mark, because I know the methodology and how much work you put into this is huge, and the questions are great, but it's that sticking with it and comparing it year to year. So no question, just a comment.
Mark, well, just one of the, not a question either, but one of the economic indicators, that you know, something to keep in mind is at any given time you take a snapshot of the number of properties on the market. So when we talked about the other high-performing districts, you can take a look at, you know, as of November 15th, Brighton, Penfield, whatever, and then that could also be broken down in those statistics by our school districts, too. So it's just something that possibly could be tracked that might be a more accurate indicator to add to what, you know, we've been coming up with. So, but I agree. I mean, you've always been, like, right within, I mean, you could put a dollar on it and you're there, so...
Good. Thank you. So with that, that's an important part of our goals, assumptions, and guidelines. Both of these documents are stage setting for the budget process. We need to be thinking, and in the document around goals, we talk about how many kindergarten sections are we going to plan on. So that planning is important for work to this. I'm not going to go over that document again because we spent quite a bit of time on it already, but I just want to touch on a few key assumptions, the ones that are going to be more important in this year's budget cycle or on ones that have changed since the last time. So we tweaked this. My earliest first look at the enrollment projection, which was included in the first draft, was slightly lower than this, so we've increased that a bit based on the refined projection. We're projecting that most of those kids, 36 of the 71 kids that this projects to come now, will be at the elementary school level, and that over time, over 5 years, we're going to grow by 5.5%. So those projections are important for two reasons. They're important because we need to be able to plan in the short term how many kindergarten kids are we going to get next year, but we need to be able to justify our planning to the State Education Department as we look towards capital projects. They're not going to they're not going to authorize additions if we can't show with some justification anticipated growth into the future. So because they're not, you know, they pay for it. They pay 70%, they pay 70 cents of every dollar we spend on construction, and they're not interested in spending money for students that can't be justified. So they understand how this works, and they ask for 5 and 10 year enrollment projections to be able to substantiate what you're asking for. So this moves towards that. Also, we at the last meeting, we didn't yet have information on either teachers' retirement system rates or on health insurance. So we now have that. Some good news and some bad. So teacher TRS rates are anticipated to decline slightly. So there's much more extensive discussion about this in your packet. I don't, and in the revised goals and assumptions document, I don't expect this to continue into the future, honestly, but for 1 year at least, we're getting some relief in terms of a decline. So this year we're at 11.72 for 17. They release a range. It'll be between 9.5 or 10.5. They haven't finalized that, and they'll do that later in their process. So that's good news. At least in the short term. Health insurance, however, is going to increase for the majority of our employees who are on what the lowest of the traditional plans, the value plan. That increase will be 11.5%. For employees on select or extended, the rates will increase upwards of 13.2%. We'll estimate for the second half of the year, because that's a calendar year program, rates at about 12%. Retirees over 65 are going to increase, depending on their plan, also by between 6 and 13 or 14%. So fairly significant, bigger increases than we've seen in health insurance and then in the last couple of years. So we'll need to be able to accommodate that in our budgeting. And then I think this is news and is going to be in a very important part of this year's conversation, and that's the state's fiscal condition. As of the last report, we didn't have, we had the first quarter update. The state's budget begins in April, so it runs April through May. We had the first quarter update. We didn't have any further information from that. This is based on a comptroller's update after the state mandated first quarter. As of that time, this is we have additional information that's not even in this slide yet because it just happened at the tail end of last week. But as of the comptroller's update, personal income tax collections were down $919 million less than projected. And the comptroller noted that essentially the state was balancing its budget using funds from the, since 2014, they've had about $9 billion in one-time settlement funds from various banks. So the bank settlement funds are one-time only money, and their plan, their stated plan was to use those for capital projects, which would be a fine use for them, to use one-time money against one-time expenses, repair the state's infrastructure, establish some reserve funds, that kind of good fiscal management. This recent report, they've used 1 in 6 of those dollars to fund ongoing expenses, so they're sort of slipping down that path. And certainly, personal income tax collections falling short of budget isn't going to help in this year's budget cycle because they're going to need to make that up. So at the tail end of last week, the Division of Budget released their half-year report. So with halfway through the year, how are they doing? And it's gotten a bit worse than this. So this will frame, I think it's useful to understand how this is going to frame this year's budget debate and our state aid. With the personal income tax collections, which is funding a majority of the state's budget continue to lag and are lagging a bit worse than even this projection. So based on the Division of Budget's mid-year report, they're projecting, based on a traditional budgeting model, deficits going into 2018 of about $3.5 billion, the following year $7 billion, and the year after that $9 billion. So expenses exceeding revenue over the course of the next several years at a growing rate. The governor prefers a different model of projecting those deficits because he assumes that he'll be able to restrain spending at a rate not to exceed 2%, and he's been successful in that by cutting state agencies. We all know some of the results of that. The state has funded greater increases to education, but they've been cutting elsewhere throughout their agencies to maintain that overall 2%. If he's able to maintain that, the deficits on the go-forward budgets are about $700 million, much more manageable, $2 billion, and $1.9 billion, I think. Again, more manageable, but he has to maintain spending at a 2% increase. The most interesting part of this year's budget is going to be also on tap will be renewal of the millionaire tax that expires this year. And if that's renewed, it's a 29% surcharge on single filers over $1 million and family filers over two. So they pay an extra one. It was a short-term fix of an additional increase in their rates of 29%. The one quarter of that will cover the 1 year shortfall. So they can make the 1 year shortfall go away by renewing the millionaire tax and by restraining spending to 2%. So there's going to be that to me just opens up a world of possibilities and debate in a year as we march towards a 2018 governor election and what that portends for the future. So school aid will be difficult, I think, this year. There's going to be lots of conflicting agendas on the table. They'll be facing a state deficit. And we know that that because gap elimination adjustment was fully funded last year, that any changes to us will have to happen in foundation aid, which means it's just a big rock to move in terms of a state budget. It takes a lot of money to make any real change there. So this is important news, I think, as we look forward. That for us, of course, we continue to live under the tax cap. Last year, the allowable growth based on inflation was almost nothing, 0.12%. Our tax base grew at 12%, and that helped us out quite a bit. So our maximum levy was 1.5%. When we our adopted levy was at 1.2. We were not just under the 2% quote unquote cap, but under the much lower maximum levy amount from last year. We don't know what this year is going to bring. We know it's not 2%. I'm estimating a 1% inflation rate, and if we estimate going forward what our carryover is and some growth in the community, I think we'll be at about 1.7% in the maximum allowable levy increase. So that means not 2%, but for this year, we can't exceed 1.7. We'll get more data on this in the next few months, and we'll continue to update it. But the one thing that hasn't changed, and I always feel compelled to mention here, is there has been no mandate relief that was originally coupled to the tax cap. So we'll see how that goes as we move forward. We touched on this before, but I just want to remind the board, we're growing. We know we're growing. We know we're not going to be able to do anything about that in the short term. Space is fixed in the short term. In the long term, it's not fixed, but it requires planning. So we're doing that. Facilities Committee continues to meet. The owner, architect, construction manager meetings are happening bi-weekly as we manage our ongoing projects and plan for the future one. And the one that we are currently talking about designing now and beginning to get closer and closer to being able to make solid recommendations has to do with, in part, enrollment growth. So classroom additions at Cobble, Scribner, and Indian Landing to address crowding. Additions at Harris Hill for BOCES special education classrooms. We had a tour of BOCES with Mr. Nelson at the last, in between our last board meeting and this one, so we could look at their program, understand what their needs are, and they came and looked at our building to see how our building might suit their needs. So we're continuing those conversations. No decisions have been made. We've reached out to the State Education Department to better understand how state aid might work on this, because honestly, that could either make or kill this proposal. But just wanted to update the board that we're continuing to work on that and to understand that. Other part of the projects are based on our building condition survey, so improvements and renovations. Just keeping the buildings in good repair. And finally, a development of a facility for buildings and grounds on district property on Atlantic Avenue, and then replacement of the existing bus garage at its existing location on Five Mile Line Road. So with that, at our next board meeting, tax cap update, so I hope to have more information then as to where we're at with regard to our growth in the community, our projected growth in the community. We'll also talk about a budget forecast and reserve plan. And with that done, in January, we'll begin presentations of the budget components themselves. So in January, the administration budget program, the special area programs of the instructional budget, staff development, special education, and so on. That we'll have a board workshop prior to the February 7th meeting, where we'll review the capital portions of the budget. End of February, second program, the general instruction budget, BOCES in March, and by the end of March, we need to have a final proposed budget so we can adopt on April 11th. It happens, seems like we just got done. It seems like too soon to be getting started, but it'll be over quickly. So we're just really beginning to rev that up, and we'll be spending a lot of time talking about that over the next many meetings, because we have to be ready for that May 7th public budget hearing and the May 16th vote at the high school from 6 to 9. Are there any questions?
Camille.
With respect to the slide you had on long-range planning, the potential classroom additions at some of the schools, I just wanted to bring up something that came up that from the convention, where sort of looking totally what you might need in a new building. And perennial, as we do building tours, we see that a lot of the pull-out spaces have been inadequate, and we have professionals in windowless rooms and that kind of thing. So as we look at new classrooms, it might be smart also to look at additional pull-out space. That's sort of something, recommendation for the facilities committee and all that, because it's not just the classrooms, it's all the support space that you need for it.
Absolutely. We've had those conversations, and actually, depending on which building you're at, some of our elementary schools have gym space that's adequate, and some are right on that bubble. Scribner's cafeteria, for example, is already very tight, so if we add, and we know what it looks like, you saw it on your tour. I think we were there when they were lining up in the hallways for that. So, you know, what does it look like if you add four classrooms to that? Do you need to add footprint to the cafeteria? You know, that's more expense, certainly. So does that fit into your budget? Is it necessary? All of that is part of this planning. Yes.
Anyone else? Any questions? Mark, one thing, and you would be able to find this more than I would, at least. And when the governor signed the casino law bill in effect in 2013, it provided for more revenue.
Right.
And for the first time, it allowed the state to collect monies from the Native American casinos, but also the new ones. And the newest one is going to come online in March, just east of us in Seneca County. And I'm just wondering if any of that income has been figured in.
Don't know that. I don't know that. That's an interesting question. I'll look into that.
Yeah, because there's another casino as well in another part of the state, and the state under the legislation was divided into two zones, downstate and then upstate. So literally anything north of Westchester is included in that. So I don't know if there's something to look at, because maybe the state's already figured it in, but it's out there. Okay. Thank you very much. We're on page 3 of our agenda. We're moving to, since we're on that, the approval of the 2017-2018 goals, assumptions, and guidelines that Mark provided for us. If I could have a motion, a second, that the Board of Education approve the 2017-18 budget goals, assumptions, and guidelines that were presented today and at the board meeting on October 18th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions, further questions, comments? All those in favor? Thank you. As Mark did mention, we did our Scribner and Bay Trail tours. We will be looking at the BOCES tours after the first of the year, I think we talked about, and not only the BOCES, but possibly the their bird school too, which is their seventh and eighth grade operation as well. So we'll try and get that on the calendar.
K-7.
K through 7. Definitely. Yeah. They keep shrinking it or growing it, I don't know. But it's a big operation,
yes,
let's put it that way. Along with the other one on O'Connor Road, which is huge. So, and I think it'd be great for us to go back there and see that. We also did update our Board of Education strategic plan, and we talked about this a little bit in a previous work session. So we have that in the packet. There are some timely things that we'll really have to get focused on after the December break, I guess we would say. And, you know, believe it or not, we probably only have 10 or 11 meetings till the end of the year after that. So all of which will be focused on Mark and the budget, among other things. But we'll keep working on that. Anybody have any new business to come before us?
No, I have a question.
Yes.
About the strategic plan, is it okay to put the Facebook page offline, or do you still want to keep it there? I mean, we've had it with the message that we were merging with the district and all of this.
I think that the time is there to do that,
okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Nancy can probably facilitate that.
I can.
Can you do it? Okay, yeah. I mean, because we're if you get those updates, we're getting a lot of views on the combined page.
Exactly.
Which is great, more than we ever had. So that was a good strategy. So, yeah, let's do that. Great point. Any other business to come before us? If not, I'll look for a motion to adjourn at 8:59 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.